Right, so we'll start the session for today. I hope you can see the screen and hear my voice. So last week we started the session on normalization, and I also proved that there can be insert, update, and deletion anomalies which can occur when we are trying to do an insert operation, update operation, or delete operation. But I also proved that using SQL, the database management system does not allow us to violate insert, update, deletion anomalies. And we discussed about these constraints which can be violated during these operations. And I also proved how the SQL will not allow this to occur. But when it comes to data constraints, such as the functional dependencies, the transitive dependencies, the multi-valued dependencies that we had discussed in previous sessions. So those, there is no way to prevent them unless we normalize the database to a higher level of normalization. So I introduce the normalization as the goodness of database design. So I discuss the aims of normalization as to reduce the anomalies that can occur. In other terms, to reduce the violations of schema-based constraints and data constraints. So violation of them is known as anomalies. So to prevent them, we use the normalization, and also to minimize the repetition of data. So these things we discussed last week, right? So today I will introduce the normal form. That means the normalization forms. Based on the level of normalization, the normal forms are categorized, right? So we'll see what those normal forms are. So they are numbered according to the level of normalization. So I had already told you that in a relational database system, any relation which is implemented in the database system should exist in the first normal form. So the first normal form is the lowest level of normalization. Okay. So the lowest level of normalization, or the minimum level to exist as a relation, or in other terms, a table in a relational database management system, is known as the first normal form. I'm just listing out the normal forms here, and the conditions to exist in these different types of normal forms will be discussed in coming slides in a little moment, right? So the higher order normal form than that is known as second normal form. So likewise, according to the first, second, third, these normal forms are there. And in between the third and fourth normal form, there is an intermediate normal form as this one, Boyce code normal form. This is kind of an extension of the third normal form, but it is not the fourth normal form. There is another one known as fourth normal form. So there are more higher order normal forms such as fifth and sixth normal form, but those normal forms are rarely used in database designs. Usually, the database designers stop from third normal form. So if the database system is in third normal form, it is considered as a good level of normalization. But for your understanding, in this syllabus, we are going to cover higher order normal forms more than third normal form, that is Boyce-Codd normal form and fourth normal form will also be discussed in this discussion, right? So even though I listed out the normal forms like this, so I didn't consider what are the features of the tables to exist in each of these normal forms. So there is a rule that if a database in higher normal form, then automatically that database in the lower level of normalization also. So in other terms, for an example, if I say that the database in second normal form, then it must necessarily be in the first normal form also. Unless it is in the first normal form, it cannot go to the second normal form. So likewise, if it is in fourth normal form, then it should satisfy the conditions for first normal form, second normal form, third normal form, and Boyce-Codd normal form. But if the database in second normal form, it does not say that it is in a higher order normal form. We can't say that if a database in this normal form, we cannot guarantee that it is in this normalization form. To check that, we have to check the conditions which satisfy this. But by default, if it is in higher normal form, it will be automatically in all the lower level normal forms. For example, if it is in third normal form, then it should be in first normal form and second normal form also. But we cannot guarantee the higher order normal form. We should check whether if it is in this normal form, then it should satisfy the conditions. Okay, so we'll go one by one. What is this first normal form, second, third, and likewise. Okay, first we'll consider the lowest level of normalization. So normalization, when the term comes to your mind, that is done to reduce the, especially the data anomalies and to reduce the repetition of data. And it is the goodness of design which achieves those aims of normalization. So in first normal form, we say that it is in a table is in first normal form if its domain is atomic and single value. So usually there are not much conditions to satisfy a given normal form. There are usually two conditions, right? Okay, so that is for any normal form. But when it comes to the first normal form, I had also told this in the introduction to relational databases also. Any table which is implemented should be in the first normal form. That is the rule in relational databases. At any table, the lowest level of normalization is first normal form. That means it should satisfy the conditions to be in the first normal form, right? So as I told you, there are always two conditions to be in a given normal form. So to be in a given normal form, there are two. To be specific, for first normal form, there are two: as domain constraint and key constraint. So these are nothing but two of the schema based constraints that we had discussed. So to be in the first normal form, these two constraints should be satisfied. Domain constraint we had discussed, that is the given attribute should be atomic and single value within its domain, right? So what is atomic? Atomic means it is not composite attribute. So I had also introduced in previous session also, composite attributes are not allowed in relational databases. And also they should be single value. That means multi-valued attributes are not allowed. But those things are allowed in high level design. So for example, in ER diagrams, we notate the multi-valued attributes. Within an oval, we can notate this is a multi-valued attribute, but when you map into the relational model, those, if there are multi-valued attributes, those should be separated into a different table. So in case there are composite and multi-valued attributes, it will violate the domain constraint, because the domain constraint specified that every attribute must be atomic and single value, right? And also the key constraint. There can be multiple candidate keys if there are, but only one of them can be the primary key. That means the primary key must be identified. Primary key must be identified, right? So these are the two constraints which should be satisfied for a given table to be in first normal form. So assume that there are multi-valued attributes in our high level design. So in that case, what we are going to do in order to normalize into first normal form, for example, take this up. If our entity in our entity relationship diagram is vehicle, and it has a multi-valued attribute known as color. So you can see that here, this is the primary key, and this color attribute with this bracket notation, you can identify it as a multi-valued attribute. So that means for a given primary key, this has multiple values. This color attribute has multiple values, but that is forbidden in the first normal form. So what can be done is, if there are multi-valued attributes, take them into a separate table. That means that multi-valued attribute and primary key of the original relation is taken into a separate table. That means this part is broken. This part is broken, and so it is taken into another table like this. That means the combination of the previous primary key and the multi-valued attribute will form the composite key in the resulting relation. So that's what I have described here. So there is a primary key, but here, as there is a multi-valued attribute, you cannot implement this in a relational database, right? So in that case, what you can do is remove this primary key along with this multi-valued attribute and take into a separate table. In the resulting table, the former primary key, this one, and the multi-valued attribute together will form the composite key. So these two together will be identical. For example, this VH001 and red, VH001 green, these two are different tuples. So you can see that this composite attribute will be distinct will form distinct tuples in this relation. So this will form the composite key, and the rest of the attributes you can keep. If there are more attributes, you can keep with the with this primary key like this. Other attributes are kept without changing, and this is broken. This multi-valued attribute is taken to a separate relation known as, you can identify it with any name, and this that multi-valued attribute and the former primary key will together form the composite key in the resulting relation. So that is one thing to keep in mind when forming the relational database from the ER diagrams. If you have a multi-valued attribute, that's how you map. So not only it should be atomic, sorry, single valued, but it should be atomic. That means if there are composite attributes, what you should do. So this is the way to tackle with composite attributes to satisfy the first normal form. So if there is a composite attribute, you have to break down it into atomic attributes in the same relation. That means in the same table. For example, if there is an composite attribute as address, as the first normal form does not allow you to have composite attributes, what you can do is you can break down this composite attribute into three atomic attributes known as street, city, and country, which will form this composite attribute. That means these three within the same table, without breaking into a separate table. If there is a composite attribute, you can divide that composite attribute into atomic attributes and implement in the same table. So then it will be in first normal form. Why? So what are the two conditions into be first normal form? The primary key is identified. Yes, there is a primary key. There is only one unique attribute, that it is the primary key. It is identified. Yes. The first condition is satisfied, that is key constraint is satisfied. Second is domain constraint, which is there cannot be multi-valued attributes and composite attributes. There are no multi-valued and composite attributes. So it is the same for previous case. So how to check? We have to check whether these two conditions are satisfied, domain and key constraint. What about the key constraint here? Yes. These two attributes form the composite key, which is the primary key. So it is identified, and this relation does not have any multi-valued attributes or composite attributes. This is true for this one. So these two are in first normal form. So that is the most important normal form that you should understand in database system, because any table must be in first normal form. Otherwise, the SQL will not allow to insert values into those tables. It will not allow multi-valued attributes or composite attributes, because it will violate the domain constraint. And the key this will violate, because there will be the primary key constraint will also be violated if you have multi-valued attributes. So here the primary key is having red and green both. That means it have two values, right? So this, that is about first normal form. That is somewhat easy to understand, because you have in our examples of the employee table and head table, you must have seen this kind of table. You didn't see any multi-valued attribute or composite attribute. Okay, that is the basic requirement for a relation of a relational database management system, first normal form. But as the aims of normalization are to reduce the anomalies, that means constraint violations, data constraint violations, and repetition of data. So you can see Here, there is a repetition of data. This one is repeated. When we map, when we try to get this one into the first normal form, this multivalued attribute, there is repetition. Likewise, if there were more data, data will be repeated. So we can break down these tables more and try to reduce those repetitions. So we need higher forms of normalization, right? So we'll go to the next level of normalization, which is the second normal form, right? So as I told you, this also having two conditions to be in the second normal form. The first condition is it should be in the first normal form. A table will not be in second normal form unless it is in the first normal form. That means the previous normal form. It is true for all other normal forms also. So to be in third normal form, it should be in second normal form. To be in fourth normal form, it should be in Boisson normal form. Likewise, it should be in the previous normal form. So that is the first requirement. That is to be in the first normal form, right? It should be in the first normal form. That is the first requirement. And the second requirement is a data dependency. So the lecture on data dependency, I introduced you about the functional dependencies. There were two types of functional dependencies, as full functional dependency and partial functional dependency, if you can remember. And there was another type of dependency known as transitive dependency. And I introduced another kind of dependency as multivalued dependency. So if you can remember the definition of partial, or take the functional dependency itself, functional dependency. What is a functional dependency? So for a moment, just concentrate on this table, this student course table, right? So if you can remember, I introduced a notation to represent the functional dependencies, right? So a functional dependency exists from one or two attributes to another attributes of a relation. We say that there is a functional dependency from X to Y when Y is uniquely identified by X. So if you cannot remember, you can go back to your lecture notes and refer. So here the student ID uniquely identifies the student name. So with this orange color notation, here from student ID to student name, there is a functional dependency. So in this table, there is a composite key. Student ID and course ID will form the composite key. That's why it is underlined in dashed format. That means this is a dashed line, this is a dashed line. That means these two together will form the key of this relation. So as this is a key, these two will have a functional dependency to all other attributes, because this is a key. Always a key attribute is having functional dependency to other non-prime attributes. So you must have to remember about prime attributes and non-prime attributes. What is a prime attribute? I introduce prime attribute if it belongs to a part of a key. So here, student ID and course ID will form the composite key. So in this table, student ID is a prime attribute, course ID is a prime attribute, and these three attributes are non-prime attributes. These three are non-prime. So there is a functional dependence. That means these two uniquely identify these non-prime attributes. So there is a functional dependency. And not only that, there are some other functional dependencies from course ID to course name, because a course ID will uniquely identify the course name. For a given course ID, there is only one course name. With this ID, there is no any other name. So this course ID will also uniquely identify course name. So there is a functional dependency from course ID to course name. So if I go back to first normal form, there was nothing about data dependencies. First normal form all about schema based constraints. It was all about schema based constraints. And the fact is, the SQL will make sure that schema based constraints are not violated, so that it will make sure that the table will be in first normal form. Right, but from second normal form onwards, second, third Boyce code normal form and fourth normal form, those are all about data dependencies. Right, so we have to deal with the dependency between data. So I am describing about the functional dependencies in this student course table. So you can see in other way also, this course name also uniquely identify the course ID. That means for a given course name, there is only one course ID. So if you cannot remember the definition of functional dependency, that is, there is a functional dependency from the attribute X to attribute Y. If the attribute X uniquely identifies the attribute Y, that is the definition of functional dependency. But the fact is, here if you observe, there is a partial functional dependency. So what is the definition of partial and full functional dependency? A full functional dependency exists. So there is a functional dependency from the set of attributes X to Y. If an attribute from the set X can be removed and still the functional dependency exists, then it is a partial functional dependency. If you cannot remove an attribute from the set X without removing the functional dependency, then it is a full functional dependency. For example, here, take this red color functional dependency. So there is a functional dependency from student ID plus course ID to student name. That means these two together will form a functional dependency to student name. But also, there is a functional dependency from student ID itself to the student name. Student ID will uniquely identify student name, and these two together also will uniquely identify student name. That means you can remove this. So for this combined attribute functional dependency, that means this red color, if you remove the course ID, still the functional dependency from student ID to student name still exists, as you can see in this orange color. Therefore, this red color functional dependency is a partial functional dependency. That's the meaning of partial functional dependency. That means you can remove this attribute that, and still there is a functional dependency from student ID to this one. So this dependency from these two to student name is not a full but a partial functional dependency. There is another partial functional dependency from, so if you take these two together and to course name, if you take these two together as X and this as Y, course name as Y, these two together will identify course name. But the course ID will alone, without the student ID, will also uniquely identify course name, because for a given course ID, there is only one course name. So because of that, you can remove the student ID and still this green color dependency exists, so that this dependency from this two to the student course name is a partial functional dependency. So what is said in the second normal form is only fully functional dependencies are allowed. Partial functional dependencies are not allowed in the second normal form. If you take the formal definition, every non-prime attribute must be only fully functional dependent on any prime attributes. So these are prime attributes. So for a given prime attribute, they should be only fully functionally dependent on those prime attributes. So if you take this one, these two together will have a partial functional dependency, as I explained before. This is one and this is one. That means this is one, this is one. So due to those two partial functional dependencies, this table is not in second normal form, but it is in first normal form, because there you can observe that there are no multi-valued attributes and composite attributes. So it is in first normal form. So it is satisfied. Not in second normal form, because every non-prime attribute is not functionally dependent on any key. That means there are partial functional dependencies. It is not all are not fully functional dependent. The requirement is every non-prime attribute, that means these three should be only fully functionally dependent. So in order to make this one into second normal form, we have to do the normalization. So how to do the normalization? For the attributes having the partial functional dependency, we have to take them into separate table. For example, so you can see there is, because of this student ID and this student name, because of this orange color functional dependency, this will become a partial functional dependency. So what we can do is we take student ID and student name into a separate table as this one. We take into a separate table as this one. So what is happening is, this is broken down into this table. So if you get this table only, there is only one prime attribute. So this is the primary key. This is the only prime attribute. And this is a non-prime attribute. So this condition is satisfied. Every non-prime attribute is only fully functionally dependent. There is only one prime attribute. So you cannot remove this attribute and keep this functional dependency. If you remove this attribute, this functional dependency also is removed. So this is a full functional dependency. This is a full functional dependency, and this is in first normal form. So it will satisfy the second normal form. And we have to do that for the other partial functional dependency also. We have to break this course ID and course name into another table. Course ID and course name into another table with this one as the primary key, because the relationship exists from this one to this one, and also it will uniquely identify this one. But here we can declare this one as the primary key, and if necessary, this one can also be considered as a key, because this one also uniquely identify this one. So is this in second normal form? So every, it says every non-prime attribute must only be fully functionally dependent. So here, so if you can see here, this is, this will also be a prime attribute because of this relation. If this is unique, if this is going to have a functional dependency from this attribute to this attribute, then this will automatically be also unique. This should be also be unique, right? This should also be unique because this is unique, and this, there is a functional dependency from this one, because this one uniquely identify this one because of this. I mean, I'm talking about these two, because of this green one and this purple one. You cannot identify this as non-prime because these two together will be, both will be prime attributes. So there is, if you consider the condition, it say that if there are non-prime attributes, they should be fully functionally dependent. But in here, there are non-prime attributes, both are prime attributes. So, this condition is, should be satisfied if there are non-prime attributes. If there are non-prime attributes, those non-prime attributes must be fully functionally dependent. But here, both are prime attributes and they have a functional dependency from one to this one. So this is a full functional dependency and this is a full functional dependency, but none of them is non-prime. So we need not to worry about this condition. This condition exists if there are non-prime attributes, but there are no non-prime attributes. So we need not to worry. It is in first normal form. It is will be automatically in second normal form. And so these two are okay. This is okay. This is okay. So the remaining one is this one. So the remaining one, if you consider these two together and this one, for this attribute, this functional dependency from this red one, from this student ID and course ID to this project, is a full functional dependency. Why? Because if you remove the course ID, then the functional dependency to this project will vanish, because these two must be there always to form this functional dependency to the project, because none of other attributes will have a functional dependency to this project. Only these two together will form the functional dependency. So these two will have a full functional dependency to this attribute. So you can keep this attribute in the original table like this one. You can keep this attribute in the original table like this one, and you can break these two partial functional dependencies into these two tables like this one. So this functional dependency, this from this one to this one, this project is remaining because it was a full functional dependency. You cannot remove this attribute and keep the functional dependency. So it remains. So if you take these three tables, all three tables are having full functional dependencies, no partial functional dependencies. So it will be in second normal form. So what are these dotted lines? So I use, and I also encourage you to use these dotted lines to represent the foreign key constraint. So when you normalize a table, you cannot break the relationships which exist between the attributes. So even if you break this, remove this, there is a relationship from this student ID to student name. So that is there. But previously there was a relationship from these two together, to the student name. That means student ID and course ID both together had a relationship to the student name. Even though we break the table, that relationship still should exist. If we break the table like this and we do not relate those broken tables, then this the previous relationship is broken. So we need to relate this student ID in here with the student ID in the original table. So here, in this table, student ID alone is not a primary key. It is a partial key. It is part of a composite key. This is the composite key. It is a part of a composite key. So this is a partial key. So this has a foreign key constraint with this student table. In the student table, student ID is a primary key. So this is a primary key. So this says that this student ID is a primary key in a foreign table. The foreign table is a student. In the student, this student ID here is having a foreign key constraint. That's how you should break the table such that the relationship between the data is not violated. If you break without a foreign key constraint, then the relationship between the student name and course ID is not having a proper constraint. That is, this schema-based constraint is not properly broken down in normalization. So if you want to, so that the normalization should be done in such a way, you can reform this table if you want. That means this is the second normal form. These three tables are in second normal form. If you want, someday you must be able to reconstruct this lower level normal form table out of these higher level normal form tables. So for doing that, in relational algebra, you will come to understand an operation known as joining tables. So if you want to reconstruct this table, you have to join these two tables based on this student ID. You have to equalize this student ID and join. In such case, if you had not a foreign key constraint, there may be data anomalies here. That means the data which does not exist in student table may exist here. If you didn't have foreign key constraint, that means with the passage of time, some person may enter data here, which is not here. So in such case, when you reform this table again some other day, there may be some violations and data anomalies can be there. Schema-based constraints will be valid. So to make sure such things do not occur, when you break tables or when you normalize, make sure that you do such with a foreign key constraint. So in the high level database to relational mapping, I introduce you the foreign key constraint with a solid line, but I have revised and updated the lecture note as dashed line, because otherwise it will make you confused with the partial and other full functional dependencies. That means it will confuse you between the data dependencies and foreign key constraint. So the notation for foreign key constraint you can use as a dashed line. For the data dependencies, you can use a solid line. So from there is no arrow to there is an arrow. So the foreign key, dashed line, data dependency, solid line. That's how you should notate in representing table structures. So it's same here. So we broke this course ID and course name into this table. But there is a foreign key constraint from the original table course ID to this table's course ID. So this will become a primary key. That means a key here, a key. This is having a key, and it can be or may not be the primary key. However, this is unique, and this one from course ID in this project table to course ID in course table, there is a foreign key constraint like this one from here to here. So in normalization, you should not only worry about these normalization conditions, but when you break tables, you should do with foreign key. That means this referential integrity must also be considered. So in individually, even though the normalization conditions are satisfied, but data anomalies can occur if you do not have the foreign key constraint specified like this when you normalize. That is true for all other normal forms. When you break, the original the relationships should exist without damaging. That means there was a combined relationship between student ID with the combination of student ID and course ID to student name, and we broke it, but there it has the relationship with here. So it means these two are having a relationship with again the student name. That means this combined relationship still exists, but we have broken down into separate table. That's a different story, but the relationship should exist, right? So those are some key things to understand in normalization, right? So I hope you understood about the second normal form. So it should be in first normal form, and only full functional dependencies should exist, right? Okay, so there is a simple way to understand whether a given table is in second normal form or not. That is, if your table has only one candidate key, and so if you have that as a one candidate key, so then automatically it will be the primary key. So it will be in second normal form. So this second normal form violation occurs, you can identify when there is a composite attribute forming a composite key. So here there was a composite key, that's why there was a partial functional dependency. If you have only one key and that is the primary key, then so a primary one key will always have a full functional dependency. If you have only one attribute as the key, then always you will have full functional dependency, because this will fully functional determine other non-prime attributes, right? Here also it is here this is not this case, but here you can identify that case. Here there are two keys and there are no non-prime attributes. That's why this became a second normal form. But as a rule of thumb, this is true. If there is only one key, then you need not to worry anything. Then that will automatically be in second normal form, because it says it should have all the non-prime attributes must only be fully functional dependent on prime attributes. There is only one prime attribute and all other will be dependent on that. So this keep in mind as a rule. If you cannot remember, just remember these two. Right. So this is how I have represented this one. This one, how you represent in letters. And so it is only in first normal form. I have normalized this into this form. I already have explained it. Okay, so we'll go for the third normal form. So the third normal form deals with another type of data dependency. So you must have remembered about the transitive dependency. Transitive dependency. If you cannot remember, you can go back to your lecture notes and refer. So the transitive dependency was also a functional dependency. Functional dependency through an unprime attribute. That means if there is a functional dependency from X to Y, and there is a third attribute Z, and there is a functional dependency from X to Z and Z to Y, there is an unprime attribute called Z, such that there is a functional dependency from X to Z and Z to Y, and there is also a functional dependency from X to Y. There is a functional dependency from X to Y, X to Z and Z to Y. That means X to Y functional dependency is transitively dependent through Z. That means there is a third attribute called Z, which the functional dependency is transitively dependent through it. So in such case, we call it as a transitive dependency. So in this table, we'll check the normalization conditions. Is this in first normal form? Yes, because, so forget about the right hand side, this normalization, just concentrate this on this table. If you consider this table, it is in first normal form because all attributes are atomic and single valued, and we have identified the primary key. And is this in second normal form? Yes, we can use the rule that I introduced a moment ago. This is only having one attribute as the key, and it is the primary key. So this will be automatically in second normal form, because if you observe, there are only full functional dependencies, no partial functional dependencies. If you get the dependency from this one to others, it is full functional dependency, no partial functional dependency, because you cannot remove this employee ID and keep the functional dependency remaining. So this is in second normal form, because it has only full functional dependencies, no partial functional dependencies. But what about the transitive dependencies? Transitive dependencies. If you consider the dependency from employee ID to consider department head, there is a full functional dependency from employee ID to department head. But there is another functional dependency from department ID to department head, because department ID uniquely identifies department head. So that the transitive dependency condition is satisfied, because this department ID is a non-prime attribute. So there is, from X to Z, there is a relationship. From Z to Y, there is a relationship. And from X to Y, there is a relationship. So employee ID is transitively dependent, having a transitive dependency to department head through department ID. So there is a one transitive dependency here. And also there is another transitive dependency, because this red color dependency, department head uniquely identifies department ID. For a given department head name, there is only one department ID name. So that there is a transitive dependency from employee ID to department ID through department head. And there are more transitive dependencies because this area, the teaching area of a given employee or a lecturer is also uniquely identifies the department ID, because for software it will be always EI, for structural it will be always CE. So area will uniquely identify department ID, and also area will uniquely identify department head. For software it will always be this name, for the structural it will always be this name, for hydraulic it will be always this name. Likewise, this area is also uniquely identifying this and this. So this has a full functional dependency from area to these two. But as there is a full functional dependency from this one to department ID, and it is having it through this area also. That means if you consider XYZ notation, this is X and this is Y, and area is Z. It is transitively, so if you consider this as X and this is as Y, X to Y is this one. It is transitively dependent through this Z area. That means this dependency come from this one and come back here. X to Z to Y. And there is another one to the department head also. So from X to Y, it is department head, but it is transitively dependent through area. So this table is in first normal form and second normal form, but it is not in third normal form, because the third normal form has a requirement that no transitive dependencies are allowed in third normal form. This table, employee table, is having many transitive dependencies, as you can observe here. So we'll see about the requirements for to be in third normal form for a given relation or table. So as I have said, you can guess the first condition. First condition should be it should be in the previous highest normal form. The previous highest normal form is second normal form. So a third normal form database must always be in second normal form. That is the first condition. And the second condition is that every non-prime attribute must be non-transitively dependent on every key. So this is, if there are multiple keys, still those transitive dependencies should not exist. What is meant by this statement is there cannot be transitive dependencies. So you can see here, this is a non-prime attribute. This is the prime attribute in this table. These all four, department ID, area, designation, and department head, all are non-prime attributes. All are non-prime attributes. And you can observe from this prime attribute or from this key to non-prime attributes, from this key, employee ID to department ID, there is a transitive dependency from area. There is a transitive dependency from department head for department ID. For department head also it is same. There is a transitive dependency from employee ID through area to department ID. There is another one. There is transitive dependency from employee ID through department ID to department head. So for the non-prime attributes, for these non-prime attributes, department head and department ID, there are transitive dependencies through other attributes. either area or department ID or department head. These none, some of the non-prime attributes are having transitive dependency. So this condition to exist in third normal form is violated. So what we can do in order to this condition to satisfy, we can break those transitive dependencies into separate table. We can take those transitive dependencies into separate tables and keep other attributes which are not affected. For example, this designation. This designation is not having any transitive dependency. This designation is not any having any transitive dependency. So you can keep that with that remaining in the table. You can keep that remaining in the table and you can remove other dependencies. For example, you can keep one. So this is having department ID is having a transitive dependency through area and department head. So if the department ID is in a table, then both area and department head cannot exist. Both, if department ID is in a table, area and department head cannot exist. So we can remove these two, area and department head, and form this table. This table was formed not by nothing but removing this area and department head. Then the only remaining functional dependencies will be from employee ID to department ID and designation. No functional dependency between these two or these two. Only the remaining functional dependency will be from this one to these two. So this is in first and second normal form, that is for sure. And is this in third normal form? Yes, because there are no transitive dependencies. So simple as that. Okay, so we did one thing, but we have to take care about these two. Then we have to check whether these two can exist in a single table. Can't, because there is a functional dependency from this one to this one. So this one will functionally determine this one, area and department head. And so because of that one, we cannot keep these two and this in a single table, because if you keep this one together, again, because of this one, there will be transitive dependency. So you have to break these two into two tables. So first one, I broke this area. This area I took into this table with department ID. I took this with department ID. Maybe you can, this is not the only way of normalizing this. You can even, instead of area and department ID, you may even take the employee ID, no problem. But the amount of data repetition may change, right? So if you take department ID and area, right? So area will functionally determine department ID. So if you get this one, the data repetition will be less. If you get employee ID and area, then there will be data repetition. That means for EE001 also software, EE002 also software. If you break like that, there will be data repetitions. So as this area functionally determine department ID, so you can break this area and department ID together into a separate table and remaining thing is this one, department head and department ID. So there is a functional dependence from department ID to department head, and there is a functional dependence from department head to department ID. So you can keep these two in a single table. So as I told you before, these two will be two separate keys, and these two both will be prime attributes, right? Both will be prime attributes. So the third normal form discuss about transitive dependency from for non-prime attributes. It does not tell about any prime attributes. So there are only two prime attributes. There are no non-prime attributes. So the only functional dependencies exist are also full, and there are no transitive dependencies because there are only two attributes and those are prime. So this is in third normal form. As I told you before, when we break the tables, we should not break the relationship between data. So in here, area, and when you break this one as, when you break like this, area and department ID based on this functional dependency. So in this table, department ID is a key. So you can refer this department ID here using the foreign key constraint. This dash line, dash blue line, specifies the foreign key constraint for this department ID in this table. And also note that one, in this table also, this department ID is having foreign key relationship between this key, right? So likewise, maintain the relationship between data such that data anomalies do not occur. That means when you break tables, you get this department ID in three places. So in here, the department ID was only in one place. So the data anomalies cannot occur. But when you break to satisfy the conditions of normalization, the same attribute went into three different tables. Same attribute went for three different tables to satisfy this condition. That means to break the transitive dependence. In such case, there should be this data in this department ID. This table should be consistent with what is in here. So to have that consistency, we should have foreign key constraint, right? So how to break a given second normal form into third normal form is, first we should identify the transitive dependencies. So I identified the transitive dependencies like this. So here there is a transitive dependency because of this relationship. There is a transitive dependency because of these two relationships. So this blue one, red one, and green one are the ones causing the transitive dependencies. So what I did is just take those attributes into different tables. So I took area and department ID into this table. And so the other one is area, department ID, and department head. So area and department ID into one table, this table, and then these two, which is representing this green and red color, department ID and department head, was taken to another table. And this non-prime attribute designation, which did not have any transitive dependency, was kept in the original table like this. So what we have to do, identify the dependencies and break, but to be consistent, you must have the foreign key constraint. Okay, so we have covered three forms of normalization. So if I go back and remind you, first normal form specified about not having multi-valued attributes and composite attributes in a relation, and the second condition was the key constraint, which is if there are multiple keys, only one is identified as the primary key. So those were the two constraints for the first normal form. And in the second normal form, the special requirement was that every non-prime attribute should be only fully functional dependent on given prime attributes, should have only full functional dependency. Partial functional dependencies cannot exist. And in the third normal form, the special condition was every non-prime attribute must not have transitive dependencies. That means transitive functional dependencies for non-prime attributes cannot exist. That is the definition of third normal form. Right, so this is how this is shown. So I have already explained that one. So we'll go for the next normal form. So this is considered as an extension of the third normal form. Extension of the third normal form. This occurs because of having multiple candidate keys. So take this, for example, employee table. We'll check the conditions of normalization. First normal form, obvious, because there are no multi-valued and composite attributes. What about the second normal form? So this is a composite key. These are partial keys or prime attributes, these three: department, employee birthday, employee name. These three together will form one candidate key, and UPF number is forming another candidate key. Another candidate key. So what about these three, the functional dependency from these three to other attributes? Are there partial functional dependencies? That means, can you remove one of these attributes and keep these dependencies exist? No, because there is no any functional dependency arising from one of these. There is no functional dependency starting from one of these. So therefore, this orange one is a full functional dependency. Orange one to these three are full. And this one, green one. So this is another candidate key, UPF number. So it will uniquely determine each of these three, each of all other attributes, including these prime attributes also. So it is again a full functional dependency because there is only one attribute, and it is uniquely identifying others. So this is a full functional dependency. Are there transitive dependencies? So for that one, we should check. So there is a functional dependency from expert area, or in other terms, area to department. That means electronics will always be in electrical department. Environment will always be in civil department. So this area will uniquely identify department. But is this a transitive dependency or not? So we'll check. So there is a dependency from here to here, right? So if you consider the dependency from UPF number to department, it is transitively dependent through the expert area. to here, department. So from UPF number to department, there is a transitive dependency, but this attribute is a prime attribute. So if you go back and refer the condition for the third normal form, it says that every non-prime attribute of the relation must be non-transitively dependent on every key. Every non-prime attribute, it's the third normal form discusses the transitive dependency for non-prime attributes, not for prime attribute. Here, from UPF to department, there is a transitive dependency through expert area to department. There's a transitive dependency, but it is not considered because this department is a prime attribute. The transitive dependency is considered only for non-prime attributes. In the previous cases, the relationship from X to Y, if you consider Y is non-prime here, you can observe it had a transitive dependency from department ID to department head. So department head is non-prime. And it is same for here, department ID. It had from both from area to department ID and from department head to department ID. And this is non-prime. So that's why it violated the condition for third normal form. But here, this transitive dependency, for example, from UPF number through expert area to department is not considered for third normal form because it is prime. Department ID is a prime attribute. Why? Because department ID is part of a composite key. These three together form a composite key. So department ID is a partial key. So a partial key is known as a prime attribute in relational databases. So this is in third normal form. The final conclusion is because it has only full functional dependencies and the transitive dependency existing is not for a non-prime, it is for a prime. So it is in third normal form. But is it in third Boisecot normal form? So we have to check what are the conditions for Boisecot normal form. So you can guess the first condition. First condition is it should be in the previous highest normal form, which is third normal form. So this, for in order to be in the Boisecot normal form, it should be in third normal form. And the next condition is somewhat tricky. So for all the functional dependencies, X must be a super key and Y must be non-prime attribute. X must be a super key and Y must be a non-prime attribute. So consider this, the orange one. So the set of attributes for X is department, employee birthday, and employee name. So this will be X and all this will be Y. So if you consider the set of Y, here X is a super key. Okay. So if I remind you what is a super key, it is a set of attributes which can form distinct tuples in the relation. That means in the given table, if the set of attributes form distinct tuples, that means distinct different rows, it will be a super key. A key is always a super key. Key is known as the minimal super key. So these three together will form a minimal super key, or in other terms known as the key. And this Y, It says y must be a non-prime attribute. If you consider this city, y is non-prime. But if you consider UPF number, this is not non-prime. This is prime. From x to y, for all the functional dependencies from x to y, y should be non-prime. That is the condition for Weierstrass normal form. But here, this UPF number for this orange relationship, this UPF number is non-prime. So this condition is violated. That is true for this green color one also. So from UPF number to others, you have this functional dependency. This expert area is non-prime. City is non-prime. Okay, this is satisfied. But for all these three attributes, these are prime. So these arrows, these functional dependencies to these ones will violate this condition, because it says that y must be a non-prime. So this will happen when you have multiple candidate keys. If a table is in third normal form and it has multiple candidate keys, then it will violate the condition for Boisecot normal form, because some prime attributes will be having this relationship as y. It says that y must be always non-prime. So how to tackle this kind of situation is, you have to divide this two candidate into two separate tables. You must take this candidate key into one table and this candidate key into another table. But the relationship should exist. Those should not be violated. So how to do that one is, so there is another. So even though this is not a transitive dependency, there is a dependency from expert area to department. So if you just remove this one and keep this one, then it will try to form a transitive dependency. So this should be taken to a different table, this expert area and department. So I created this table from expert area to department. It is, so then this data constraint is taken into a separate table, and then the next one is separating these two candidate keys. So for that one, so I have already taken expert area, so we have to separate this one. So what I can do is, we can keep these first four attributes in this table and remove the other two. So then what happens? Then only these, as I have shown here, these will be remaining here. Only these will be remaining in this table. So this will have a full functional dependency. So there are no transitive dependency. And is this condition satisfied? Yes. So these are the prime attributes and this is the non-prime attribute. So y is non-prime. Full functional dependency? Yes. So it is in second normal form. No transitive dependencies. It is in third normal form. Y is always non-prime. It is in Boisecot normal form. And UPF number can be taken into a separate table, but it cannot be taken alone. So if you take this alone, then this relationship will be lost. So in order to have this relationship, that means out of the normalized table, as I said before, you should be able to reconstruct this lower level of normalized table. For that one, these data dependencies should exist. So from UPF, as seen in this green notation, there are functional dependencies from this UPF number to this. So they should still exist even we normalize. So how we make sure that we can have UPF number with one of these attributes. So then what will happen? I have taken expert area, and that expert area is a foreign key in this table. Expert area and department ID, because of this red color relationship data dependency, I took this one into separate table, and here it is the primary key, and this will have a relationship with this one. So UPF number now will have a relationship with department, and this department will be a foreign key in another table, not in any of these table, but particular in table like this one, this head table, department ID and department name. So the department ID is a primary key in this table. So I'm referring to that table here. So this department ID is a foreign key in that head table. And so that when you join these two tables, UPF number will have a relationship between department. And you can join this table also with this head table by, because of this foreign key constraint, because in this table department ID is a foreign key in this head table. So you can join this table with this table, and you can join this with this, and you can join this with this. Then ultimately you can form this table, and all of these relationships from UPF number to each and every one of this will exist. You can reconstruct this green color relationship. You can reconstruct by joining these tables later. That's why you should have foreign key constraint. If you do not specify foreign key constraint, then you can never construct this table back. You cannot construct this table back. You may construct, but not without anomalies. There may be anomalies when you try to reconstruct, because of insert, update, delete operations. After you form these three tables, the data may not be consistent. For the data to be consistent, you have specified the foreign key constraint. So the Boyce-Codd normal form, what ultimately specify is that for all the functional dependencies, y must be non-prime. So is this in second normal form? Because yes, only functional dependencies. Third normal form? Yes, because no transitive dependencies exist in this table. Is this in Boyce-Codd normal form? Yes, because this attribute is non-prime here. There is a functional dependency, and y is non-prime. This table also true. There is a full functional dependency and no transitive dependencies. And this y, in this full functional dependency, y is non-prime. Here also y is non-prime. So this condition is satisfied, because it says that for all the functional dependencies x to y, y must be a non-prime attribute. So in other words, as I have given here, multiple candidate keys are not allowed in Boyce-Codd normal form. That is another way to interpret this. So both are same. Even if you say that multiple candidate keys are not allowed, or for all the functional dependencies x to y, y should be non-prime, both are same. This is violated when multiple candidate keys are mixed in a relation, as like this one. This is a key, this is a key. Because of that one, some attributes of these functional dependencies for the attribute y were not non-prime, some were prime like this one, some were prime like this one. So we should avoid that one in Boyce-Codd normal form. That's what this normalization form takes place. So I hope that it is also clear to you. So you can refer this back and try to understand. If you, in case you did not understand, you can visually understand using this dependency notation. Right? You can see here for the dependencies x to I, there are prime attributes. Here you don't have prime attributes, only non-prime. So the condition, whether those conditions are there or not, you can visually understand when you represent the functional dependencies, or in other terms, data dependencies and other constraints like this visually. Okay, so we have discussed four types of normal forms, from starting from first to Poisson quad normal form. So this one specified that the will not allow multiple candidate keys in a relation. So the simplest way of understanding those normal forms are, as a summary, first normal form doesn't allow multi-valued and composite attributes. Second normal form does not allow partial functional dependencies. Third normal form does not allow transitive dependencies. Fourth normal form, sorry, Boise quad normal form does not allow multiple candidate keys. That is a summary up to now, right? Okay, so we'll go for the last normal form that we have to discuss in this context. So I hope you must have remembered about the multi-valued dependency in the lesson of data dependencies. So multi-valued dependency exists in a relation because of one-to-many relationships that you may see in ER diagrams. In ER diagrams, if you have one-to-many relationships, in such case, this multi-valued dependencies can exist. And also, if more than one multi-valued attribute is there in your ER diagram or high-level database design, for a given entity, if you have two or more multi-valued attributes, then this multi-valued dependency will exist. For example, take this table, so employee table, for a given birthday, employee name, employees can be born on the same day with same name. For example, some person called Sunil from mechanical department can be born on this day, and some person with the same name as Sunil, another person, can be working in the electrical department. So employee birthday has a multi-valued dependency from employee birthday to employee name. So I hope you must have remembered the notation of multi-valued dependency, that is notated with a solid line with double arrows, right? So that means if one value of one attribute has multiple values, not like functional dependency. In functional dependency, X will uniquely determine Y, but in multi-valued dependency, X will multiply determine Y. In such case, we say that there is a multi-valued dependency. But we discuss about two cases of multi-valued dependency, that is trivial and non-trivial. So simply explaining, a trivial means in mathematically the meaning is zero. That means no meaning. Trivial means no meaning. There is no meaning in that dependency. So trivial multi-value dependency exists when there is only one multi-valued dependency. That means if there was only employee birthday and employee name, there is only one multi-valued dependency. So in that case, we call it a trivial. But in here, we have this department as also a part of this multi-value dependence. That means from employee birthday to department. That means two employees can work in the same department having same birthday. That means two different employees with two different names. Two different names can work in the same department. So this is a case like in the high level ER diagram, there was an entity known as employee, and it has two multi-valued attributes as department and employee name. So during the first form of normalization, what happens if there are multi-valued attributes? They should be taken into a separate table with the primary key of the original table. That's what I explained you at the beginning of this lecture. If there is a multi-valued attribute of only one or more multi-valued attributes, those multi-valued attributes, so this department and employee name can be considered as multi-valued attributes. So they are taken with the original table's primary key to form this table. So in that table, even though we have the first form of normalization, so this is in first normal form. Why it is in first normal form? These are not multi-valued. Only one row will have one value. And is it in second normal form? Yes, because this has no any functional dependency. If a table does not have any functional dependency, then it will be automatically in second normal form, third normal form, and Poisson-Kot normal form. Why? Because second normal form, third normal form, fourth Poisson-Kot normal form all talk about functional dependencies. If there are no functional dependencies, it will automatically be in Poisson-Kot normal form because there are no functional dependencies. So up to first normal form, second normal form, third normal form, and Poisson-Kot normal form, this table is satisfied. But during the first normal form creation, normalization up to the first normal form, that means when we break the multi-valued attribute into a separate table like this, there is a non-trivial multi-valued dependency. Non-trivial multi-valued dependency in simple terms is there are two multi-valued dependencies from one attribute to two attributes. There are two multi-valued dependencies, two or more. In such case, we call it a non-trivial. That means meaningful multi-valued attribute. That means dependency. So the first normal form specified. So as by this time, you must understand that it should satisfy the previous normal form, which is Poisson-Kot normal form. And the second condition is it can consist of only trivial multi-valued dependencies. So this one, even though it is in Poisson-Kot normal form, it is not in fourth normal form because of these two multi-valued dependencies, it is having non-trivial multi-valued dependency. Because if you remember, x from x to y or z is denoted as the multi-valued dependency. So from x to y, there is a multi-valued dependency. From x to z, there is a multi-allele dependency. In such case, we call that it is a non-trivial multi-allele dependency. But how to get rid of this non-trivial multi-allele dependency is very simple. Just remove one of these multi-valued attributes. That means you can take employee birthday with department into one table, and you can take employee birthday with employee name into another table. Then there will be only one multi-valued dependency, and due to one multi-valued dependency, then it will be from X to Y. That means there is no Z here. There is no Z here. That means X union Y or Z is forming the whole table. That is the correct mathematical definition of non-trivial multi-valued dependency. If you remember, if you can't remember, you can go back and refer the slides on data dependencies. If X union Y co Z, that means this one is forming the whole table, then this is a trivial multivariate dependency. In simple terms, in simply explaining, there is only one multivariate dependency, so because of that it is trivial. So how to convert a non-trivial into trivial is remove each multivariate dependency separately into different tables. Remove each one into different tables like this, so it will be a trivial dependency. So this is trivial, this is trivial. So you can see the reduction of data here. If you consider here, there are in a row there are three and there are four rows. That means all together you need 12 units to store this data. But to store the same thing, you if you normalize into 2, you only need this one 2 into 2 4, this one 2 into 2 4, all together 8. Only 8 units are required if you normalize. But in here, due to non-trivial multivariate dependence, you need more data. That means you can see here data is repeated. Data is repeated. So if you have more and more non-trivial multivariate dependencies, data can be repeated unnecessarily. That's why you need to break into trivial dependencies and normalize, as in both normal form. That is just to reduce the repetition of data. So this is the requirement of fourth normal form. It is relatively somewhat easier than other normal forms. So just you have some multivariate dependency, non-trivial one, with multiple multivariate attributes defined in the high level database design. What you have to do is take each of them separately with the attribute as X. So if this is X, X to Y and X to Z, take X with each multivalued attribute and take into different table. So if you take this kind of table, that is definitely in first normal form. No need to worry about second normal form, third normal form, Boyce-Codd normal form, because these tables don't have functional dependencies. If any table is not have functional dependency, then remember that those tables are always in second normal form, third normal form, and Boyce-Codd normal form, because all of those, if you can remember, those are defined for functional dependencies. For example, second normal form was defined based on full functional dependency. That means it said all the non-prime attributes must be full functional dependent on any given key. Third normal form specified that all non-prime attributes must be transitively dependent through for any given non-prime attribute for all the functional dependencies. Transitive dependencies through non-prime attributes are not allowed in third normal form. In other words, and in the Boisson-Godd normal form, it said that for all the functional dependencies, y must be a non-prime attribute. So you can see all of them are defined for functional dependencies. So when there are no functional dependencies, they will be automatically satisfied. So fourth normal form says that it can only consist of trivial multivalued dependencies. As you can see here, they are trivial multivalued dependencies. So these will satisfy the fourth normal form also. So those are the only normal forms that you have to understand in this database system syllabus. There are higher normal forms, but we are not going to discuss on that. And you will not be tested on those things. You will be tested only up to the fourth normal form. In your project, you have to normalize up to a second normal form, as I can remember for your assignment. You have to normalize your database into second normal form. That means you should ensure that only the full functional dependencies are there. In other words, if there are composite keys, you should break. And there are partial functional dependencies arising from those composite keys, then you should identify the functional dependencies and break into separate tables as I described in this one. So that is all about the normalization. So I missed only one thing here. As a rule, you can remember that an all key relation is always in Boisson-Godd normal form. So what is meant by an all key relation? So this one is an all key relation. That means all the attributes are prime attributes. If all the attributes are prime attributes, then it will be in Boisson-Godd normal form always. That means it is, if all the attributes are prime attributes, then that means there are no functional dependencies for non-prime attributes. So for example, assume that there are two candidate keys in a relation. There are two candidate keys in a relation, and those two candidate keys are the only candidate keys in that relation. So that means one candidate key will functionally determine other candidate key. I'm talking about an example like this one. Like this, an example like this one. There is one candidate key and there is another candidate key. So both of them will become prime attributes. This will functionally determine this, and this candidate key will functionally determine this. Is this in Boisson-Godd normal form? Yes, because the requirement for Boisson-Godd normal form is for all the functional dependencies, y must be a non-prime attribute. X must be a super key and Y must be a non-prime attribute, right? So that is the condition. So an all key relations is not this one, right? So if there are multiple candidate keys, that is not allowed. So if this is multiple, so this is not in Boisson-Godd normal form, right? An all key relationship is not this one, right? An all key relation is something like if these two are the only available attributes, and that is part of one composite attribute. So this is a different case. This is a table, and it has only two unique attributes. That means there are only twos as the only attributes. That means this will functionally determine this, and this is not a prime attribute. Sorry, not a non-prime attribute, and this is determining this. This is not a non-prime attribute, so this is not in what is called normal form. So this is not what I meant by all key relation. All key relation is something like this one. This is an all key relation. That means the all of the attributes will together form the primary key. That means all of the attributes together considered will form the key, and there is no any unique key forming that table. In such case, all of them will be prime attributes, and there will not be any functional dependencies. In an all key relation like this one, there are no functional dependencies. You can observe there are no functional dependencies in all key relation. So an all key relation will automatically will become in Boyce-Codd normal form. So this is what I have represented this table. So that concludes the discussion on normalization. But remember, all key relation is this kind of a relation which is composed of composite attributes forming a key together. The whole relation is forming a key. But in this case, this is not known as an all key relation. This is a relation with multiple candidate keys. As in Boyce-Codd normal form, as I have given here, multiple candidate keys are not allowed within a relation that is not in Boyce-Codd normal form, and that is not an all key relation. Right? So that is the end of normalization. I invite you to go through this lecture and again try to understand. If you couldn't understand, get anything out of this lecture. So this is important for understanding database design, and for your project also, up to second normal form understanding is necessary, and for your exam up to fourth normal form it is necessary. So you should try to get an understanding about the normalization, so you know the aims of normalization and the normal forms by now. So the first normal form was based on schema based constraint. Second, third, and Boyce-Codd normal forms were based on functional dependencies, and the fourth normal form was based on multi-valued dependency. So that is the summary of this lesson. So next week we will start the session on relational algebra, and that concludes today's session, and we'll start relational algebra starting from next week. So if you don't have any questions, you can leave. If you have any questions, you can ask. Right then, so we'll meet next week, and I'll upload this lecture as soon as possible, and I'll upload this PDF to the LMS also for you to refer. and make sure you do the project, and you can do up to chapter 4, I think. By this time you can complete up to chapter 4. Okay, thank you.